Well, thank you for that. I almost wondered who he was talking about for a minute there. But and I do want to tell you about the Bearing Precious Seed Ministry, but I want to take a few minutes and kind of tell you how we got there from where we were. And so, as you know, 20 years, we were missionaries in Belarus. And Belarus has always been kind of a difficult place to be able to operate, and every year it was kind of a question whether we would be able to renew and stay there. And it was always, the Lord always provided, and sometimes it was at the last minute, but he always provided, and we were always able to stay. And so during COVID, we were back here and couldn't go back to Belarus. And during that time in late August, they had a presidential election. And this is going to sound real familiar to you a little bit here, but they had a presidential election. And during that election, there was a lot of fraud that took place. And the opposition candidate, yeah, imagine that, right? The opposition candidate was extremely popular. And so like a month and a half or so before the actual election, he was arrested on corruption charges. And he hasn't seen the light of day since. And that's just a fact. But then what they weren't anticipating is then this guy's wife assumed his candidacy. And so she's running for the president of the country now. And she becomes extremely popular, mostly because the president's extremely unpopular. And so this election is going to take place. And so they were expecting fraud there. And so they had the social media is a wonderful thing sometimes. And so they were able to communicate with each other. And so they put somebody at every poll in the major cities. And they spread the word that when you come out of the polling place, to put a ribbon on your finger when you came out if you voted opposition. And they counted 3-1 with those people with the ribbon on their finger. And then that night they announced the election results, and the president won by 85% of the vote. You know, and so they went out in the streets and began to protest. And when I say this, I mean this seriously. It was absolutely 100% peaceful protesting. In fact, they even picked up their garbage after they left. I mean, it just, and I'm not exaggerating, it was absolutely peaceful protesting, but they sent the riot police out there. And so that went on, these protests and the riot police and compression grenades and smoke and the tear gas and things. And that went on until it got too cold to protest. So it went on from August until late December that was going on. And so that began to sour the relationships with Europe. And so this guy that was organizing all of these protests and everything, he fled the country. And so one day, so we went back in 2000, early 2000, 21. Or 21, thank you. I don't know where 2000 comes from, but 21. We went back in 2021. And so when that happened, so we were there just a couple of months, and this guy, this blogger that organized everything, he's flying from Greece to Vilnius, Lithuania, and part of the flight is in Belarusian airspace. And so while the plane's in Belarusian airspace, the pilot is informed that there's a bomb on the plane, or a threat of one. So they land at the airport. The police come on and arrest this guy and his girlfriend. They send the plane on its way. So there's no bomb. It was just to get this guy arrested that they were looking for. When that happened, Europe imposed an air embargo against Belarus. No planes from Europe could fly into Belarus, and Belarusian planes could not fly into Europe. And Belarusian airspace was closed. Air traffic was closed. And so from that point, the noose started to tighten. This is even before the war, with Russia and Ukraine, that this is all starting to happen. And then the buildup began in Eastern Ukraine. The buildup began along the Eastern Ukrainian border. And then, of course, the invasion took place. And once that happened, our mind was we were going to stay there. We were going to stick it out. We were going to do the best we could. And at the beginning, it seemed like it would be all right. But things just happened so quickly. They put those sanctions on Russia. Most of those were put on Belarus as well. And the reason is because 300,000, to this day, there's 300,000 Russian troops in Belarus, in the southern, the southern third of Belarus. And the airstrips there are being used by the Russian warplanes. And so they're in this war up to their necks, but they like to say they're not because they don't have troops in Ukraine. So they can say that they're not part of the war. So with all that going on, the sanctions applied to Belarus as well as Russia, a lot of them. And so suddenly the automatic teller machines, the ATMs, they didn't work. You couldn't get money, and the ones you could, the banks were imposing 20% tariffs on foreign money. And so, you know, to get $100, you have to pay $120. And so it just became really difficult to do, and some borders were already beginning to close with some of those European countries because they didn't know what was going to happen. And it just came to the place where we just thought, we need to do something. And Jeffrey was having difficulties adjusting to all this. He wasn't sleeping at night. We were having, you know, our own issues with that kind of stuff. And it just became evident that we couldn't continue the way we were going. It just wasn't going to be able to be sustainable. And so we decided that it was best that we leave. And so we did that. And we did all that. And, you know, all that I said, that it was all in about a week and a half's time. That all that, huh?
4 days.
4 days. Well, once we made the decision to leave, it was 4 days and we were gone. But it was about a week and a half while all that stuff was going on. And so we left, and then we came back to the States, and then we had to figure out what to do next. And you know, we considered a number of different things. And I'm a missionary today because of a joint effort with Couriers for Christ, which you guys know because you know Larry Ingalls. He's your interim pastor, I understand. you know what they do, and it was a joint effort between Couriers for Christ and BPS. Now it was BPS Milford, not so much in Oshkosh, but still, I went on this campaign in 99, and I think you know this story, but I went on this campaign with Bearing Precious Seed and Couriers for Christ put this together, and it was to put 1 million New Testaments in 10 major cities in Russia over the period of 6 weeks, I think it was. And so I went on that, and I really wasn't expecting to do much more than go on the trip and come back. I was working at Wildwood. I was one of the associates there, and I expected to go back to that. But while I was there, God called me to the ministry, to the missions, and back to that area, Russia, and then ultimately Belarus. And so for me, it seemed like a very natural transition to make, because my ministry started with the scriptures and distributing the scriptures. And so it just seemed a very natural thing to produce those scriptures. And then as I was trying to, you know, waiting on God and trying to decide exactly what God wanted, the beginning of this year, I began to just go in the print shop unofficially, not just a regular helper, but several days a week, and just start working in that ministry and see what it was about and to see what it was like. And I did that for several weeks, and there was a missions trip to Puerto Rico they were going to take, so Jeffrey, Helen, and I, we went on that Puerto Rico trip. I kind of wanted to see the full, you know, scope of the ministry and what all it was that they did and how it worked. And that was an experience. You know, I like I said, I've distributed scripture before because I was there in 99, and then Pastor, you and I were there in 2001, and we helped the couriers in Lithuania a couple times. But this was different because this was the first time that I had ever produced the scriptures with my own hands, and then traveled to the country and taken those same scriptures out and distributed them to people. And that was just a blessing. I can't even tell you how much that just thrilled my heart to be there and to be able to take those scriptures out that we had produced in Oshkosh and begin them to hand them to people and to see how they wanted to take them. I mean, that was a blessing. We'll show this video in a minute, but it's interesting because the guy's name is Luis. He was instructing us on how to go about doing this distribution, because they do it, and you'll see that, but they do it on the streets, and you saw that, actually you saw that Sunday morning. But and they hand them out to people in the cars. And so he's saying, what you got to do is you got to get that, you got to get that up there real high and have a smile on your face, you know, and just let them know that this is something important, and they'll take them from you. And I've been in the dark corners of Belarus way, way too long, because nobody would give you the time of day, and you'd be out on your ear by the end of the day if you tried that. But he says, you know, put that up high and smile, and those guys will take it. And he's telling me this, and I didn't think he was lying. I mean, I'm not saying he's a liar, but I have to admit, I thought, yeah, right. Yeah, that's really going to work, you know. But that's because I've been in the dark corner of Belarus too long, you know, where you just don't do those things. But you know what? I did what he said, and guess what? It was just like he said. They were ready to take it. And so it was really exciting to see that. And so let's go ahead and show the video, and then I'll talk a little bit more about some of the things.
The Christian family, Jeff, Helen, and Jeffrey, were missionaries to the former Soviet Union for 20 years. Before going overseas, they served on staff at Wildwood Baptist Church for 10 years. Jeff went on an evangelistic campaign in Russia, where God called him and his family to Belarus. The Christians were part of two church plants in Belarus, Bible Baptist Church in Ratomka, where Sergei is now the pastor. The second church is Emmanuel Baptist Church in Minsk, Belarus, where Vladimir is now the pastor. Jeff and Helen's experience working in a country closed to the gospel gave them the burden and the vision to get the word of God into the hands of people around the world. God has since called them to be a part of Bearing Precious Seed at Wildwood Baptist Church.
There is a great need to print more scripture that can be distributed around the world. That is why Bearing Precious Seed was started in 1979 by Jim and Monica Hoffman. BPS produced over 12 million scriptures in 40 plus languages since then. But the world keeps growing and more scriptures are needed. The scriptures printed in BPS can go places you will never get to go. They can change the eternity of a people that you will never meet. They can be handed out for a new church plant and change a life, a town, a country. The scriptures will be around even when we are gone.
For their participation in helping us to be able to get some scriptures over to the country of Kenya. So there's about 30 different churches that of independent Baptist churches that we work with our Bible college there, and so they were going to be using these as well. But we just thank God for the scriptures that are being made available, and there are refugees that come in also from those neighboring countries that are closed. And so we're praying that God would use these scriptures here behind us to be able to get into the hands of those people who could likely go back into those closed countries. So,
most of the time, the finished products are sent out to equip missionaries and local churches around the world. Sometimes we get the privilege to hand out God's word on missions trips. This next video is a clip from a mission trip to Puerto Rico.
If you die today, where are you going to spend eternity?
I'm going to heaven. I'm going to heaven.
And what did Jesus Christ do for you on the cross?
He died for my sins. He died for my sins completely.
Praise God.
To you, who made all of this possible, thank you for everything. I am completely speechless of what happened to me. I'm still shaking. Thank you for making this possible. Thank you for saving my life. And thank you. Thank you.
I'm very thankful to the donors who decided to give these Bibles to our students and the teachers. I am very hopeful that with the coming of this donation, we are going to see a very big impact on the behavior of the teachers and even the students.
We are grateful to everyone that helps support Bearing Precious Seed, those that donate money for paper, supplies, and monthly support, those that donate their time and energy to help assemble scriptures, and those that pray for us. We include specific prayer requests in our newsletter that you can sign up for at bps.wildwood.org. Only 25% of the world has the Word of God. 75% do not have a Bible of their own. How will they hear and get saved if they do not have a Bible? Our mission at
And seven, you know, and just 75% of the world not having the Word of God. That's really, I never knew that, and that's really an arresting fact when you think about it, that they don't have the Bible in their own language. And so that's another reason why we're with BPS today. We want to change that so that more people have the Word of God in their language. You saw what was happening in Malawi. We're currently toward the end of it, but we're working on our third container to send there in the last 2 years. And right now, Malawi is wide open to the gospel. They're asking for scriptures. You saw the school teachers, the missionary that we're working with, Ovi Cornea, he met the head of the police, of the National Police Force. And he wants them to give a Bible to every policeman in the country. And that's part of what we're putting on this next container, our whole English Bibles to give to those policemen and others, of course, too. But we're sending the John and Romans to be handed out. And God is just, you know, when the door is open like that and God's working, we try to, like the saying goes, strike while the iron is hot. And when you have that opportunity, an illustration of that is Russia. I mean, when I went there in 99, we couldn't get those New Testaments out of our backpacks fast enough to give them there. Just 2 years later, when Pastor and I went together, it was a different story. It was a lot tougher. People didn't want them. And then the governments passed laws, and it's closed down where you can't even do that stuff anymore. And so you have to get in there while you can, so that people can have those Bibles and hear the Word of God, and more people can be like that fellow in Puerto Rico saying that his life was saved. And that's a powerful thing when you go there and you hear a guy say that you saved my life. And so we're excited about what the future holds. We're finishing up this Malawi project. And then in Indonesia, there's a place called Timor Leste. It's an island of an Indonesian island, and the eastern part of it's called East Timor. They speak a language called Tetum there, and BPS Oshkosh produced the first 100 New Testaments ever in that language. It was a 20-year project of this missionary translating the New Testament into into the Tetum language. And a couple in our church, they're friends with those missionaries. And so through them, we were able to get the text, print those 100 New Testaments. And this couple took them to Indonesia to them and gave them those 100 scriptures. And now we're going to produce more of those New Testaments. We're going to produce John and Romans in Portuguese, which is another language they speak there, and as well some whole English Bibles. And then there's some study material that they want BPS Oshkosh to help them with as well. So we'll send a container there to this Indonesian island, and these people will then be able to read the New Testament for the first time ever in their own language. And it's just it's hard for us to imagine that, because we can so freely have the Word of God. But Psalm 68 and verse 11 says, "The Lord gave the word, and great was the company of those that published it." And there's a number of ways that the scripture can be published. Obviously, we can talk about publishing it, printing it, producing it, assembling it, shipping it. But the other way that you publish it is through preaching, through witnessing, and those types of things. And you know, when Jesus Christ heals people, there's one portion of scripture, it says that the man went and published it, blazed it abroad. And so that's what we need to do, is get the scriptures in the hands of these missionaries. It's a partnership. It's a team effort. We get the scriptures in their hands, they hand them out, and fellows like that guy in Puerto Rico and others, they get saved, and their lives are changed, and that's what it's about. But we need to change that figure that says that 75% of the world doesn't have a Bible in their own language. And, you know, if you think about it, with all the modern technology and all of the money that flows around the world for all kinds of different things, it's incredible that it's that high of a percent that doesn't have the scriptures. And so at BPS Oshkosh, our goal is to change that. And so the video said 40 plus languages. The Tetum New Testament was our 45th language that we have produced scripture for and sent to a country that speaks that language. And so we ask that you'd pray for us as we continue to work this great ministry. And it amazes me what God has done with BPS at Wildwood. It just does. I mean, God, the way it started small, and God has just expanded it. And God's got greater things ahead, but we need you to pray for us. And we need you to pray for BPS. Thank you. Amen.
It's good that missionaries go around the world, but if they don't have the Word of God to give to them, it makes it very, very difficult. And praise the Lord for ministries like the ministry at Wildwood Baptist Church that's able to print the scriptures and then get it literally all over the world to people that, you know, I've seen this over and over again. I've watched, and many of you have seen this too. People get a Bible for the first time. You may not have been there when it happened, but you've seen it, either a picture or a video. They literally hug their Bible. And they're not being weird. They just so cherish it because they've never had one like that. Well, we don't know what that's all about. You know, not only do you have a Bible, you've probably got a whole bunch of them on some shelves somewhere as well. You have the one that you carry. You might, you know, some of my family has a church Bible, a reading Bible. Some people have a study Bible. There's some cultures and some countries where they don't have anything. They don't have a Bible at all. When we were over in Russia, we had the opportunity to see some people get a whole Bible for the first time in their life. They never had one before. And that's the kind of ministry that Brother Christian now is involved in. And I praise the Lord for it. That's a blessing. All right, ushers, you come, if you would. We'll take our offering tonight. And again, this is a sacrificial missions offering. David Corey Jr., come on up, please, and pray for the offering.
Father, I thank you for your goodness to us. I thank you for how you provide for us. And Lord, I thank you for the reminder of the power of Scripture. And I thank you for the blessing that we as Americans have of the ability, anytime we want, we can go to our spot where we keep our Bible and we can read it, and we can read it in our language. Help us to never take that for granted, and help us help these folks as they try to empower other people to have that same ability. And Lord, I thank you for how you do speak to us through your word, and I thank you for just the week we've had, and help us to be faithful to you and as we give. And I thank you for how you provide for us each and every day. In your name I pray. Amen.
Sing 388 in your hymn book. 388, Speak, My Lord. Hear the Lord of harvest sweetly calling. Who will go and work for me today? Who will bring to me the lost and dying? Who will point them to the narrow way? Speak, my Lord, speak, my Lord. Speak and I'll be quick to answer thee. Amen. You may be seated, and we have a special.
All right, get out your Bibles and prepare to get a blessing from the book. One of the things that's been a blessing to me this week is get to know the Mullers a little bit better. They were with us just really for one Sunday, then we took them on for support. But this time around, we've gotten to know them a little bit. And I've gotten a blessing from them. I think they're doing the right thing down there. I'm excited about the work that they have, and be in prayer for them. Not tomorrow, but now Friday, they're going to be heading on back down. It's going to take them 7 days to get back to their home, and be in prayer for them as they go. Brother Muller, come give to us what God's given to you. It's been a real blessing to have you with us this week.
Sure. The blessing has been all ours. We're very blessed to have spent these days here. It's been a good conference, amen. Mm-hmm. It really has. I know I speak for Brother Allen and his family and Brother Christian and his family. We're just very grateful to you folks, amen, putting on this. I mean, just the attentions and the fellowship, the food, just the care to us, and it's been a really good time, amen. And so we're very appreciative. You know, I've been saved 33 years, and I've never heard that song, "He Was Not Willing." I've never heard that before. That's a convicting song.
It really is.
Man, I mean, Liz and I just looked at each other and said, "Man, did you see what that said?" So that's pretty, I don't think that is rough. I just think it's very convicting, amen. So praise the Lord. So we're glad to be here, and we're here in the last night. This is it. And I guess they said unless everybody surrenders to be a missionary, they're going to cut me off. So you guys are going to have to get right with the Lord tonight, amen? But, you know, in case you didn't know it, you already are.
Yeah.
You are a missionary.
Amen.
Wherever you are, amen, you ought to be a light. And you're shining in that darkness. So tonight we're going to be in Matthew 25 for a little while. So open up your Bibles in Matthew 25. Now, before we have a word of prayer, this is a busy chapter, Matthew 25. There's the parable of the 10 virgins, parable of the talents. It has a passage that deals with the judgment of the nations. There's a lot of stuff going on. Now, I believe that you have to rightly divide the Word of God.
Amen.
I believe that. I believe that without right division, you're going to wind up a Pentecostal probably. Amen? That's the problem with a lot of folks. Their error is just misplaced truth. And but I'll tell you this at the same time, some of my dispensational friends, they're out of balance. They spend their whole life just looking at all these little nuances and trying to figure out every little component in a passage. And sometimes, you know, they just pass up the practical truth that's there. There's morals to the story. You think about these 10 virgins, and they want to identify who they are, and the lamps and the oil and all these elements, amen? We all have some ideas about it, but it all doesn't always fit. Not every little piece fits, amen? I mean, if you want to put that on the oil's the Holy Spirit. I mean, where am I going to buy the Holy Spirit? Mm-hmm. Right? So we have some trouble. And I remember my pastor, we learned dispensations there, and not just in the Institute, but in Wednesday nights. He had a big old chart, and we learned some stuff, and we got ruined in there. Amen? But you can go to seed on anything, man. You can go to seed on anything.
Yep.
And so the Lord likes a balance. And, you know, Jesus just said the basic moral of the story was just watch and be ready. I mean, that's all he was trying to teach you, amen? Now, I'm not saying some of these other things aren't there, but what I'm saying, but sometimes we miss the forest for the trees,
yep,
right?
Yep.
And he just said, you know, you got to be ready. You got to be ready. So you got to be ready to for whatever it is he has for you. So we'll go to the Lord in prayer tonight. Father, again, we come before you, and this will be the last night of this conference, and you've been good to us. You've visited us every night.
Amen.
You've used every speaker to speak to our hearts, and it's been good, Lord. And I pray again tonight, as I am accustomed to, that you would just give me a little measure of help tonight, to be used by you, to be a help to these people. These are your people. They're not mine. And you've bought them with a price. And if there's something that can be said that will be a help to them, an encouragement, Lord, I thank you for that. And I pray in Jesus' name, amen. So Matthew 25, you know, every major decision I've ever made in my life, directional, has been at a missions conference. The most important decisions I think we've ever made in our lives have been at missions conferences. We were called to the field at a missions conference. And I remember coming forward, and the pastor said, "Is the Lord dealing with you?" I said, "I don't know." I think I'm just supposed to go with that guy. Amen. And, you know, he was a missionary in Venezuela, teaching the kids of the missionaries there. You know, he wasn't a church planner. I don't even really remember what he talked about. All I knew is I felt that I should just go with him. And we came off the field a while, and it was at a missions conference again that we realized that we need to go back. You know, so things, the Lord uses these conferences because, you know, sometimes 2 or 3 days into it is when he really starts speaking to you. I mean, it takes a couple of days to just get all the clutter out. Amen. And then, you know, right? I mean, in a song service, I think you've got to sing about 10 songs before you get the world out of you. And then you can actually hear something from God. So this passage, we're going to look at the talents tonight and try to draw something out of there. And I want you to look in verses 14, and we're just going to read a few verses there. Just follow along with me. It says in verse 14, "For the kingdom of heaven is as a man traveling into a far country, who called his own servants and delivered unto them his goods. And unto one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1, to every man according to his several ability, and straightway took his journey. Then he that received the 5 talents went and traded with the same, made them other 5 talents. And likewise he that had received 2, he also gained other 2. But he that had received 1 went and digged in the earth and hid his Lord's money." So I want you to know this passage is talking about money, right? Mm-hmm. That's what it says. "And after a long time," in verse 19, "the Lord of those servants cometh and reckoneth with them." So I want you to see with me the first thing is in verse 14. Let's look at verse 14. It says, "For the kingdom of heaven is as a man traveling into a far country." And who did he call? Go ahead and answer me. He called his own. He called his own servants. So when the Lord has a job to do, he's going to seek out his own to get it done. He's not going to go and look for other people. Servants are his, and we're his servants. We've been bought with a price. And it's not that we have this slave-master relationship, but we are his servants. And these servants in this passage, you'd have to understand, for him to single out these 3 amongst probably many others, they probably were stewards. Amen? They probably had gained his trust in some sense that he would bestow upon them a responsibility. They're not like day labor. These guys, these aren't labor-ready guys that are just hired for the day, like in the parable of the vineyard. These aren't just some guys just standing in the middle of town, and why do you stand there all day just idle? Amen. These are servants of his. They belong to him, and they've already have a working relationship. Don't misunderstand me. It's not a loving, caring relationship in this type of sense, but these are men that have demonstrated responsibility. You understand? And so the Lord calls out his own. John chapter 10, Jesus says, "I know my sheep, and my sheep hear my voice." I want you to go with me to 1 Chronicles. I want you to hold your finger here in Matthew 25. So when you think about what the Lord wants done, you know, folks, we need to just look around, take a look to the left of you. And if you're over on the left side, then take a look to the right of you. That's who the Lord's looking to use. It's us. It's us. And if it's not us, then who? Right? I mean, sometimes I stand in my pulpit down in Mexico and I look out across that congregation. I think, well, this is who he gave me to use. Amen. That's it. Sometimes it's not the best thing, but it is what it is. Amen. I had a guy named Patricio, a Venezuelan, who came in, and the Lord used our work to help him, and I don't take any credit for it, but he had made some serious mistakes. He had been a pastor, and he came our way just kind of stumbling in, and after a while, I saw that he had some preach in him. He had some ability, and he had a heart to serve the Lord. And he come from a niche of people that said, once you've made a mess of your life, God will never use you again. Yeah. And we talked about some things. I remember we used to go get some a milkshake at the Burger King every couple of weeks. Not just getting to know him. And then one day he looked at me and he said, so when are you going to invite me to your church? And I said, oh, you don't know where it's at? He said, I get it. And he just started coming along. Now, where we live in the sector of our city, it's mostly a white collar area. Guys are licenciados; they're educated people. They're not going to find too many bricklayers in our neck of the woods. Now they live in the city, but not in the quarter where we live in. And sometimes I do projects. Go to First Chronicles. I said, is that what I said? First Chronicles. I'm just telling you a story till we get there. And I remember Patricio helped me in a project, and I said we were trying to make some panels out of some plywood and some 2x4s, and I got saws and hammers. I was a roofer, amen. I was a roofer for 20-something years, so I got a little bit of that kind of ability to do those things. But Patricio, no, he's never done anything like that. I don't think he knew which way the hammer was supposed to be used. But I'll never forget, this is what he said. He said, you know, preacher, I'm all you got. I'm all you got. And I said, well, praise the Lord. I'm glad I got you. Now, here in Chronicles, I want you to look in 1 Chronicles chapter 27. And look with me, if you would, in verse 25. And I'll show you this kind of idea that I'm talking about. There's a certain relationship that goes on between a servant and his master, a good master. We're not just talking about some slave driving, whip cracking type of thing. We're talking about a good master, and our Lord is a good master. And look with me here. It says in verse 25, 1 Chronicles 27, and over the king's treasures was Asmapheth, the son of Adiel, and over the storehouses in the fields, in the cities, and in the villages and in the castles was Jehonathan, the son of Uzziah. And over them that did the work of the field for tillage of the ground was Ezri, the son of Chelub. And over the I can't say him in English anymore. I'm sorry, brother. It's just not going to happen. Anyway, and over the vineyards was Shimei, the Ramathite. Over the increase of the vineyards for the wine cellars was Zabdi, the Shifmite. And over the olive trees and the sycamore trees that were in the low plains was Baal-Hanan, the Hederite. And over the cellars of oil was Joash. And over the herds that fed in Sharon was Shittrai, and the Sharonite. And over the herds that were in the valleys was Shaphat, the son of Adlai. Over the camels also was Ovil, the Ishmaelite. And over the asses was Hediah, the Moronathite. And over the flocks was Jaziz, the Hagarite. And this was just an exercise for us to learn how to say some of these names. And all these were the rulers of the substance, which was whose? King David's. Do you think these guys were just some randomly selected men? Do you think these? No. Now, these were chosen men, and they probably had other dozens and dozens of men under them, but these were the men that were given the charge because they had shown themselves to be probably faithful and able. Amen? And that's who the Lord is looking to use. Go back to Matthew 25. This master, this man who's going to travel and go on a far journey, he doesn't just come out and do the ranch and just randomly pick a bunch of guys. Hey, you and you and you. No, he says, you and then you and okay, you. Amen? That's what he does. He picks his own. He picks the ones that he has a little bit of knowledge about. And so something about these men, and there's going to be something about us when the Lord looks to get something done, he's going to look into a local church, and he's going to look at who is faithful and able. He's going to look at faithfulness long before he looks at your ability. Amen? I remember being a superintendent at a roofing shop for some years, and there were some guys who really thought that they were far and above in ability than other guys, but they were cut-ups, and they had other problems that made them unreliable. Amen? And I'd rather take some kid who probably didn't know anything and just put him under my wing for a little bit and train him, amen? And use that young kid before I'd use some journeyman roofer who was just unreliable. The Bible talks about people that are unreliable, and it says they're like a broken tooth. Amen? It's like a foot out of joint. It's undependable. And the Lord's looking for people that are in the work in the church, and they're faithful in the church, and they're doing what's needed to be done in the church, and sometimes what's needed just for you to just show up regular. Just show up regular, amen? And just be there. So the first thing that I'm not going to be long tonight, I don't think so. So he seeks out his own when he has a job to do. He's going to send somebody to the field of Mexico. He's going to send somebody to Belarus. He's going to send somebody to the other side of the world. He's not going to just find them out there on the street corner. He's going to come in here to a local church, amen, that's preaching the truth and that has faithful members and people that are serving the Lord here, and he's going to seek out his own, amen? And that's what he does. So if it's not us, then who it is? The servants are his, the goods are his. And he looks to you and I. Look with me in verse 15. Here's the second thought I wanted to share quickly out of this passage. It says in verse 15, "And unto one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1. But notice what it says. It says, to every man according to his several ability. And then straightway he took his journey." And I want to think about this idea of several ability. There are a couple things that we should think about here. Now, first of all, since the Lord knows you, and he says he knows you in John 10, he also knows what you're capable of. He knows what your abilities are. And on the other side of that coin, he knows what your limitations are. Isn't that wonderful? I think about the grace of God in this passage. The man going on a far journey, he didn't give each man the same amount. He gave 5 to a man who would probably, in his own estimation, be able to handle those 5. That was the estimation of the man traveling on a far journey. And to this fellow that had 2, he looked at him, and in mercy, "I'm not going to give you 5. I don't want to mess you up. I'm going to give you 2 because I know you do all right with 2. Most of us, I believe, myself included, we're 1-talent Christians. I believe that. I believe most of us come in at that level and we're able to do something. We're able to do something. You know, I've found very few people that have multiple gifts. Amen? That have, you know, 2 or 3 different gifts of the Spirit. Most of us just have 1. Most of us are just, you know, if you're good at administrating, you probably can't preach very well. And if you're a good preacher, you're probably not a good administrator. Amen? I mean, these are just how these things go, right? And so, you know, that's why it's called a body. And that's why there's so many different members, because not all of us can be the eye. Not all of us can be the smelling. Not all of us can be the feet. Not all of us can be the voice. We got to be something, amen? And so I look at this, and I look at this distribution. Listen to me now. This man traveling, although that man who just got 1 talent, and I'm not going to go probably down that road you think that I ought to or might, this man traveling to a far country did not make an error in judgment by giving that man 1 talent. And we'll talk about that in a minute. The distribution to me, it speaks of a certain familiarity that exists between these men. He knows them well enough to know what they can handle. He knows them well enough to know that they are able to do such and such, but probably not this. I just left our church for 7 weeks, and I thank God for some of those men. I thank God for all of them, not just some of them. Amen. Some of them give me the hiccups, but I still thank God for them. But I'll tell you what, I know who I can leave in charge. Yeah. Yep. Amen? Mm-hmm. And so I left Abraham, and I sat there with all our leadership. He's in charge. All right, so if you guys have any questions, you direct them to him. Don't be texting me every other day. Don't be calling me because I'm not going to answer the phone. You got something, you can talk to Abraham, and Abraham wants to deal with it how he wants to, he can, or you can talk to me. And you're over this, and you're over that, and you're over that. And I said, just please, when I come back, just give me a church in one piece. Don't give me two broken pieces. Amen? And they said, we'll do our best, preacher. I said, I know you will. I know you will, you know? So this distribution, that's God's grace. That's God's grace. He's not setting us up for failure. God doesn't want us to fail. God wants us to be successful at what He asks you to do for Him. And I believe God desires to say to each and every one of us, well done, thou good and faithful servant. I believe that's His desire. That's God's heart. That's the God I read about in this Bible. He wants to say that to me. Amen? He's hoping that I'll do things, some things that are right. And like I said, not every one of us are a five-talent Christian. Not every one of us are a two-talent, but at the very least, we're a one-talent Christian. Amen? And there's something that the Lord has called you to do, and there's something that you can do for Him, and you will be successful in it. Now, I want to finalize this in verse 19. Now, get down here. First of all, when the Lord has a job to do, He's going to call His own to do it. And He's not going to go outside. He's not going to go outside and hire some ringers. He's not going to, amen, He's not going to hire a professional missionary to go do the job. He's going to hire some stumbling bumpkin like me and hire me to go down to Mexico, and I'm just going to try to get done what I can, amen, with my one talent. Does that make sense to you? He's not looking for hot shots. He's not looking for, you know, the super Christians, because none of us are, especially us missionaries. Especially us missionaries. I know sometimes we get up in a conference or we come around and we just get treated. And if we're not careful, we'll believe the press. If we're not careful, you know, we're not all that. I'm not. And I know these two men that I've spent the week with, they don't think they are either. Amen. We're just servants. We're just servants. We've been given a talent. And instead of burying it, we went and put it to work. Amen. That's all that we're doing. But look at me in verse 19. This is what I want to kind of park on tonight. Just wanted to get here to verse 19. Verse 19 uses a word there called reckoneth. And after a long time, the Lord of those servants cometh and reckoneth with them. So not only does the Lord seek to use His own, and not only does He have grace in how He distributes those tasks, but one day He's going to call us into an account. Every last one of us, it's going to be a reckoning. There is going to be a reckoning. And we know what that event is. We call it the judgment seat of Christ. And we know that our salvation isn't the issue, but what we did with what we have. Last night I was talking to a brother out in that hallway, and we were talking about a verse. And he said, where it says, lay hold of salvation. And he says, you know, I struggle with verses like that. I said, you know, I think it's kind of like what it says in Philippians. I think it's like what he says, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. I don't think he's telling you got to work hard to get saved. I think he's telling us that we need to lay hold of what we got. Amen. We need to work with what we got. Amen. We need to try to do something with what we got. I got a talent. I need to do something with this talent. I just need to do something with it. Amen. Or otherwise, I'm just going to go bury it. And here's what our danger is, brethren. We tend to think everything's just going to continue like it is. The tendency is to think that things will continue as they are. And then what happens is it results in this. It causes us to think that, well, we can just get to it at a more convenient time. If I know what the Lord has asked me to do, sometimes we just put it off because we think I'll be able to get to it when I can get to it. And isn't that why Felix wouldn't get saved in the book of Acts? Remember what he said? He said, come back at a later date. Come back at a more convenient season, he said. Amen? I got time for this, but right now, I just got these other things. We don't say it like that. We don't say to the Lord, no. But what we do is we say it nonetheless. We say, well, when my kids are all raised and I got my family in order. Amen? Or we say, I'm getting close to retiring, Lord. Then I'll... Or we say, I got to get this business up and running, Lord. And when I get it all going well, then... And it's called the when and then syndrome. You know, when I get this area of my life orchestrated. And when I get this part of my life fixed up to where I think it ought to be, then I'll have a more convenient season to serve you. It's not that we are unwilling to serve them, but sometimes it's just not now. And the time is not our friend. Time is not our friend. We are running out of time. And the time is now. And if you don't have the time now, you're most likely not going to have the time then. When it's convenient for you. I'll never forget this. Years ago at our sending church, we weren't on the field yet. We weren't even missionaries. We were just folks sitting in the church. Amen? Just coming to church. And a lady who's dear, one of our dear friends, Linda, they had a rare open mic testimony time. They're rare, you know, you got to be careful with that open mic. You never know what folks are going to say. Anyway, she got up there. And she started talking about, and through the tears and through the sobs, she's told us that the Lord had laid on her heart to speak to a man at work. And she said, okay. And sometimes fear causes us to put it off or whatever, for whatever reason. She just put it off and put it off. And then she finally just got up the courage and just got ready to do it. She got a track and she went to work. And she went around to find that guy because he wasn't in his regular little cubicle. And they said, oh, man, he passed away a week ago. I'll never forget that. It almost makes me cry thinking about it right now. And the way she, you understand? And you knew you should have done something and you didn't do it. And then when it finally was convenient for you to do it, it was too late. And things don't always just go as they are right now. Things change. And we have different seasons in our life. And sometimes when the Lord tells us to do something, we ought to do it. Amen? But time is not our friend. At the end of the day, our one talent, we take it, and it just winds up getting buried. It just gets buried by the busyness of life. And it just gets buried by your dreams. It just gets buried because of your goals. And I don't think it's an intentional, malicious thing. I think it just happens. I think it's just life just takes over, and then that moment's gone. I want you to look at John 4. This has been our verse. And I'll tell you what, Brother Allen, I appreciate your treatment of that passage all week. It's been great. It's been fantastic. John chapter 4. I'm going to close with this verse. And I'll show you something in here. I wrote it down the other night sitting right here. I was looking at that. And let's look at the verse 35. Something I noticed here sitting here this week, our theme verse. I didn't speak on this theme, but we're going to end the conference with it. Amen. Lord, just give me a little something. He says, say not ye, there are yet 4 months, and then cometh harvest. Behold, I say unto you, lift up your eyes and look on the fields, for they are white already to harvest. And I looked at that, and Jesus said, you know what you say? Here's what you say. I got time. I still got 4 months. Amen? He says, that's what we say. We got a little time. Got a little bit of time yet. It's all right. We'll get to it. But Jesus says, you know what I'm telling you? I'm telling you it's ready right now. There is no more time. There's no more time. And he says, ye say there is time, but I say there is not. There is no more time. I don't know about you, but I've told the Lord plenty of times in my life, I got 4 months. There's no rush. There's no hurry. I'll get to it. And then that opportunity came and went. Jesus says, already. That word already means an actions or events that have taken place. It doesn't mean like the two words already, like everything's there. And it says, this is an action that has already taken place. The harvest is ripe. It didn't happen 4 months from now. It happened right now. It's already done. Amen? This action has taken place, and it's ready for the reaping before the 4 months came. It's completely prepared. We say in Spanish, porque ya, and just look at the my body language. Yeah. I mean, I guess you understand what that means, right? Yeah, stuvel. I mean, it's done. You understand? It's already done. And this is what he's saying. It's not 4 months from now. It's now. I don't know what you've been looking at on the news the last week. I've been looking at some serious stuff. We were talking the other day, me and somebody. Now, here's what you got to understand when it comes to prophecy. The church is not subject to prophecy. We're a mystery. And we were revealed by Paul, and he said these things about Christ in you and the rapture and some other components of what is church doctrine. That was never revealed to anybody back there. Now, you can read that stuff back into the Old Testament, and you can make applications, and that's all fine. There's no problem with that. But doctrinally, you're not on solid ground when you do that. Amen? But Israel is a subject of prophecy. And if you want to know God's time clock, you just watch that nation. Now, I don't know what's going on. I don't know how this is all going to play out, but I'll tell you what, it makes me sit up and take notice.
Yes, sir.
Big time. And I believe that, I don't believe we got 4 months. I think it's time now. If you're going to do something for the Lord, brother, you better get to doing it, or you're not going to have that moment. Jesus said it's already. It's already time to harvest. There are no longer 4 months. Now, I don't know. A lot of things could happen over there. They could just wipe out Hamas and keep on going, or all the nations will come against Israel like prophecy says. Amen? And we're not going to be around here to see how that all plays out. All right? About some years ago, we were in a church and we were just visiting. And we didn't have a meeting there. We were just visiting. And the guy that was pastoring there, I don't even know if he's still alive. He may be, but he had been pastoring. He was 91. 91. And walked up to the pulpit. Now, he didn't walk up with vigor, but he walked up. Amen. And he preached a message, an applicational message out of the book of Revelations. And when he was done, and he was talking about time no more. That was the message, time no more. And he said, you know what, folks, one day you're going to be old like me. And all your strength and vigor will be gone. And you're going to take a look over your shoulder back at your life and how it went. And there's only one or two things that you're going to be able to say. You're going to say, man, I wish I would have. I wish I would have when I could have. Or you're going to say, I'm glad I did. Amen. And either way ought to bring you to weeping. Either way, I'm glad I did. All I can tell you is I'm glad I did. I'm glad I did what the Lord told me to do when I went to Mexico. Amen.
Amen.
And I don't know how it's all going to come out in that judgment seat of Christ. I'd imagine there's a whole lot of wood, hay, and stubble up in there, no doubt about it. But I'm glad I did something. Now, we've been here for a week. Preaching, talking. And I would imagine that in a church like this, the Lord's already been working before we ever showed up. Amen. Already been working in hearts. And I just want to take a moment before I ask the pastor to come up and the musician. Come on up now with the music, whoever's going to play that piano. If you're here tonight, I want to ask you a question. Maybe you're a young person, a teenager. Maybe you're just a kid. Maybe you're getting ready to retire. Maybe you're a little older. Amen. Maybe for the last who knows how long, the Lord's been kind of tugging at you. Just kind of tapping on your shoulder a little bit. Maybe you can't put it into words real well, but something's going on. Amen. Something's going on. I don't know if I feel called or whatever that is. Maybe you're here and you're a young person. You say, yeah, that's me. Would you raise your hand? Is there anyone here like that tonight? There's one in the back. Is there anyone else? Anyone else? There's one. Amen. There's another. Three or four. I'm going to ask you to come out here. And I'm going to ask these missionaries to come up and pray for you. Come on. You raised your hand. Come on up here. Not really an invitation, but I want to take a moment. We need to nurture these young people. We need to give them an environment. Brother Christian, would you please come? And I believe I have the liberty to do this in Freedom Baptist, amen? Come on, brother. Come on. Come on, Brother Christian. And these two men are going to take a moment and pray for you, amen? Because we want to see what God's going to do with you, amen? These are the next missionaries, next pastors, next printers. The Lord's going to come here and take them out of His own. And here they are. And so now they're your responsibility. So let's take a moment. You do pray for them. Amen. Thank you. Put some hands on them. Come on. All over the world, there's just an amazing amount of activity going on. And wherever they're doing these campaigns, they're just tremendously successful. And I don't think it's for nothing. I think it's because the Lord's just going to reap what He can right now, and He's coming back for us. You're going to get something done, brother. Better get it done now. Amen. Grab you some tracks on the way out. Hand them out at work. They already know you're a nut. Right? Remember what we talked about Sunday morning. They may not like your testimony. They may not agree with it. But they can't debate it. Nope. It's your testimony, all right? Thank you so much for having us this week. God bless you.
Just explain, the invitation's open, the altar's open. What will you do with what you have? You know, at first I thought about, well, what are we doing with what we've got? Well, whatever we're doing, we're doing. But what will you do? What will you do? We have some time. Maybe not very much. But with whatever time we have, God will hold us accountable. Whatever God has given us, and He's given us all different abilities, different opportunities. What are you going to do? Are you looking ahead and saying, I will now do, fill in the blank? I believe after a week like this, God is speaking hearts. It's obvious by the altar this evening. How about you?
All right, let me have your attention. Well, if you got a blessing this week, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. I did too. Let me encourage you to stop by and thank each one of the folks that came, the Christians, the Mullers, the Johnsons. Make sure that you thank them for investing in us this week. They took a portion of their ministry and time and invested in us. And I'm thankful for it. It's been a good week. But let them know, and if there's a particular thing, that way that God has been a blessing through them, let them know what that is. That encourages someone who's in the work. It helps them understand that God took them and used them in a specific way. So let them know that they've been a blessing to you. Let's bow our heads and let's be dismissed in a word of prayer. Father, we thank you so much for your faithfulness and your goodness. We're thankful, Lord, for what you've given to us in order to be able to serve you. All of us are different, but we need to be different because there's different tasks to be done and we're to work together. Lord, I pray, Father, that we wouldn't just look back and see what we have or have not done, but we'd look ahead. Say, what am I going to do? What will I do because of what you have given to me? Because there's going to be a reckoning someday, and Lord, that could be right around the corner. Time is running out. And God, when we're gone, when you blow that trumpet and the dead in Christ rise first, and then we're right behind them. Father, our work is done down here. We can't do a thing. So if we're going to do something for you, we've got to do it now. And Lord, I pray that you'd help us to be found faithful as individuals before you. Lord, thank you for these missionaries that have been with us this week. Thank you for the blessing they've been. Lord, watch over them as they go their separate ways and go back to their ministries. We ask, God, that your hand would be upon them and that you'd bless them richly. We thank you, God, for being such a blessing to us this week. And we pray your blessings upon us for the remainder of the week. Help us to be bright and shining lights wherever we go, that people would see Jesus Christ in us. And we'll be careful to thank you and praise you for what you do in us and with us and through us. In Jesus' name we pray. All God's people said, amen. Amen. You're dismissed.